Having now sorted out nouns, verbs, adjectives, and prepositions, we can start to look at the process of making up new words. If you think about your own personal vocabulary, it's obvious that you can make up new words. We've already said that previously when we talked about nouns. You can make up new nouns. And the processes of making up new lexemes is very largely making up new lexemes from ones that already exist. This process is called word formation, and we can get some background to that when we think, well, some lexemes are morphologically simple, that is, their internal shape, their form, is not subdivisible. So, for example, the word cat and the word rat and the word mat, you can't cut them down into any smaller units. There's just a single lexeme there. It happens to have some letters in it, but the letter C, for example, in cat doesn't mean anything by itself. You've got to have all three of them, three letters or three sounds, to make a word. But you can get other words which are morphologically complex. That is, they have other lexemes as component parts. For example, in the southern United States, people catch catfish. Catfish. Well, catfish obviously consists of cat and fish. Those are the two component parts. The word cat can't be subdivided, but the word catfish can, so that makes it morphologically complex. The first thing to note about morphologically complex lexemes is that they have other lexemes as component parts. The way in which linguists talk about component parts is they often call them constituents. The component parts of anything are its constituents. Well, there are two sorts, basically, of morphologically complex lexemes. There are compounds. Let's have a look at bookshelf, for example. Bookshelf has two lexemes as component parts, the book one and the shelf one. Each of those exist independently. There are also derived lexemes like gentleness, and there's only one other lexeme inside, and that's the lexeme gentle, and it's had ness put on the end of it to make a new lexeme. So you can do one of two things. You can either put two lexemes together, and those are compounds, or you can put an ending on the end, and we'll find that these are not the same sorts of endings as we previously talked about, which were inflections. They're derivational endings. Then you get one single lexeme plus a derivational ending, and you get a new word. Let's have a look at compound lexemes to start with. And let's go back to our box diagram, only this time we've put the boxes inside. What we've got in the case of blackboard is two lexemes, black and board, going to make up a new lexeme, blackboard. Well, the new lexeme, the whole thing, is a noun, and that's why we've got the noun in the bottom left-hand corner of the box. When we look at the two boxes inside it, black is an adjective and board is a noun. One of the reasons why we've done adjectives and nouns before this is so that we could have a good look at the structural properties of complex lexemes. Well, how do we tell that a compound's a compound? How do you identify them? Well, one of the things that they often have to recommend them is that there is a main stress, a heavy beat on the first lexeme and not on the second. If we compare lighthouse, which is a compound, with lighthouse, in lighthouse the stress is on the first word, and in lighthouse it's on the second word. One of those is a compound and the other is not. A lighthouse, of course, is the thing that has a big lamp in it and it shows out at sea, whereas a lighthouse is one that just isn't very heavy. There's also a grammar, and here we're going to introduce a really important term which again comes back over and over again. One of the two lexemes in the case of a compound is normally the head part, the head constituent. Heads have important properties. The main property is that they provide the grammatical information for the whole thing. the head constituent determines the grammatical properties of the whole thing. So if the whole thing is a noun, one of the two parts is responsible for turning it into a noun. Compounds belong to all the major grammatical categories that we've looked at: nouns, verbs, adjectives, and prepositions. So for example, we can get compound nouns, we can get compound adjectives, we can get compound verbs, and there's the odd compound preposition. They also have another property. They're productive to a greater or lesser degree. What that means is that some forms of compounding make for lots of new compounds, whereas others hardly make for any. We've already seen that we can make new compounds all the time, whereas in the case of prepositions, it's impossible. Prepositions are unproductive in terms of their compounding, whereas nouns are highly productive. Catfish, blackboard, and you can make up hordes of new ones, and we'll look at some more novel ones in a little while. The meanings of compounds are generally also relatively predictable. Not everything is predictable, but something is predictable. Namely, compounds have the head word with a very important role. The head word tells you what the whole set is, and the other word, the non-head, tells you something about the subset. So what the whole lexeme denotes is a subset of what the head denotes. Let's have a look, for example, at a bookworm. A bookworm is sort of a kind of a worm. A glasses case is a kind of case. A textbook is a kind of book. A calendar entry is a kind of entry, not a kind of calendar. So the head, it turns out, is the second element of the compound, and that is not only the head in terms of its grammatical properties, but also the head in terms of its meaning. So a steamboat is, well, it's not a kind of steam, it's a kind of boat. We can also talk about the rules of compounding, letting us know that some compounds are possible but don't exist, whereas other compounds do exist. Some compounds are part of your vocabulary. You know them and other people know them. For example, a lot of people know that there are things called seahorses and sea cucumbers, sea turtles, but there are no sea cows. There could be. There could be sea cows, and there could be sea goats and sea elephants, but there aren't. We haven't needed those words, so they're perfectly possible, but they just don't exist. So a lifeboat is an existing case, but you can make up lots of new items that aren't currently part of your vocabulary. So here's a hat boat. Perfectly possible. What's a hat boat? Well, it might be a boat that's shaped like a hat, or a boat that's used for transporting hats. Notice again that the word boat tells us that this whole thing is a noun, but it's also a type of boat, just like a lifeboat is a type of boat. So boat is the head, and the head is the right-hand element of the two. So let's see if we can identify compounds on the basis of this rather cursory discussion of them. Here's a passage taken from a computer manual. In fact, it's from an Apple computer manual. A laser writer. Yes, well, a laser writer is a kind of writer, so that's a compound. It can print a document more quickly if the fonts are used in the document are stored in the printer's memory or on the hard disk. Hard disk. Okay, so laser writer doesn't have a space between laser and writer, whereas hard disk does have a space. How can you tell that they're compounds? Well, listen for the heavy beat. Laser writer, hard disk. Right, a hard disk is different from a hard disk. A hard disk is just a disk that's hard, whereas a hard disk is a part of a computer. It's used for storing things on. And it isn't actually all that hard. The case is hard. Some laser writer printers come with built-in fonts Okay, what's built in? It's got a little hyphen between it. Well, it's kind of a compound adjective, really. Very odd, but there it is. Looks like it might be a kind of adjective. Or maybe it's just a phrase that is being used as an adjective. Sometimes things aren't particularly clear. Stored in the printer's read-only memory. Read-only. Well, maybe that's a compound. You can download. Oh yes, that's a nice one, isn't it? Download. Download. It's a compound verb. Hard disk again. In the computer industry, there are huge numbers of new compound words created every day. It seems that it's one of the most fertile areas for compounding. But if you look at the whole of the vocabulary and the way it grows in the case of English, compounding is one of the most productive, one of the most common activities. New words are creeping into the language all the time, and a great many of them are compounds.